Did you know that Dracula is the fictional character most often represented in film, with the Guinness Book of World Records counting 272 appearances in movies? First introduced to us as an old man who has been living for centuries alone in his castle, Dracula moves to London, falls in love, starts murdering people, and generally Draculas it up. But after tangling with the vampire hunter Abraham Van Helsing, he is chased back to his castle and killed. In the novel, his death is not via stake, but with a knife in the heart. Also, they cut his throat. Dracula has the strength of 20 men, is able to climb walls and fly, transform himself into fog, hypnotize people, summon storms, change his age and shape, transform into and talk to animals, and create new vampires. Dracula would basically be the best X-Man ever. However, he's also predatory, cruel, and pure evil, which explains why he isn't one. There are definitely a few basic Dracula screen types. For instance, Nosferatu is sort of the first Dracula movie. Director F.W. Murnau was unable to obtain the rights to the novel, so he did what any of us would, changed the character names, and made the movie anyway. Nosferatu definitely invented the Dracula as total monster subgenre of vampires, as well as a look that still gets copied today, and also introduced sunlight as fatal to vampires. Werner Herzog remade the film in 1979. The first person to play the role in an American production was Bela Lugosi in the 1931 film Dracula, which started the Universal Monster Movie series. This is the most famous portrayal by far. People who have never seen the film recognize the mannerisms and accent as classic Dracula. This Dracula is elegant but frightening, inhuman but attractive. Take the threat and seriousness away, and Dracula's basically a weirdo in a cape with a funny accent. There are a number of campy Draculas, thanks to the character's ubiquity and his status in the public domain. What? This is Dracula as cartoon, novelty song, or commercial pitchman. Sure, he's a monster, but why can't he sell insurance and breakfast cereal? Gary Oldman's portrayal of the Count as tragic romantic turned monster certainly cast the modern mold of Dracula as timeless anti-hero, which seems to have stuck in the two decades since the film's release. Although still clearly a monster, this Dracula is actually pretty relatable. The Francis Ford Coppola-directed film is also notable for a self-aware and beautiful recreation of early film techniques. So what's Dracula stand for? If Frankenstein is a metaphor for science run amok, werewolves are unrestrained male sexuality, mummies are about the importance of moisturizing, where's Drac in all this? Interpretations include that Dracula represents sex drive, female sexuality, willingness to deviate from social norms, or a parable for Eastern European immigration into Victorian England. That last one might have been scarier if you were living in Victorian England. Actually, they all might be scarier if you were living in Victorian England. Modern interpretations of the character have all viewed these elements as attractive elements of vampirism, as they aren't shocking anymore. It's harder to make Drac a villain in an age that loves sexy, cruel rebels. How can you not like him? He plays by his own rules. He's like Han Solo with fangs. What's so great is that the character changes with time. He's been around for more than a century, and it looks like he's got another 100 years or more left in him. Wonder what he'll sink his teeth into next. We'll be right back.